audible, sir. I'm audible. Am I audible?
You are okay, ma'am. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. I'm from Chettinad Medical College in Chennai, Kelambakkam, and I'm from the unit chief is Anand Ramakrishnan sir and Sandil Kumar sir. Thanks for giving me this opportunity, sir, the second time. So I would like to present this case. The chief complaints, a 60 years old female patient residing at Kovalam, who is an housewife, presented to the surgery OPD with complaints of ulcer on the right cheek for 6 years. History of presenting illness, patient was apparently normal years back, after which she developed a small black nodule on the right side of her cheek for 6 years. It was insidious in onset and very small in size initially. It is gradually increased in size to attain the present size for past 6 months duration. History of associated with spontaneous scab formation in the center of the ulcer for 6 months. There is history of blackish discoloration present, no history of any discharge, no history of pain or loss of sensation. And no history of bleeding on touch, no history of itching sensation, no history of radiation exposure, no history of any exposure to chemicals like tar or arsenic ointments, no history of trauma, no history of any previous chronic scars, and there is no history of any other ulcer swelling in the face or neck region. There is no history of hemoptysis, no history of headache and seizures, no history of jaundice, abdominal pain, no history of fever, and there is no history of loss of weight and loss of appetite. So comorbid history, not a known diabetic or hypertensive, no tuberculosis, sepsis, sterilization done 30 years ago, family history, no history of similar complaints in any of the family members. Personal history, she takes mixed diet and attained menopause since 10 years. Summary of my case is a 60 years old presented with complaint of ulcer in the upper half of the face close to the right eye for 6 years with history of recent increasing in size and central scab formation for past 6 months with no history of pain and discharge or no other ulcers or swelling elsewhere. Sir, shall I continue with the
faculty?
Do you have any picture, image?
It is coming after this, sir, in the clinical.
It's in the examination.
Please go ahead, Balapriya. We can go ahead with the clinical thing, then discuss. No, please share your slides, complete your clinical findings also, then examiners will ask the questions. You're not able to share the screen? Yeah.
Yeah, I can. So examination, general examination. Patient is conscious, oriented, well-built, nourished. No pale rectus, synovial clubbing or generalized lymphadenopathy and pedal edema. Vitals, BP is 110 by 70 mm of mercury, measured in the right upper limb in supine position. Pulse rate is 76 per minute, right rate pulse, which is regular in rhythm, normal volume and character. Vessel wall is normal and all peripheral pulses are felt. Respiratory rate is 16 per minute and temperature is 8.4 degree Fahrenheit. On examination of face, patient in sitting position after getting consent from patient under adequate light, patient's face examined from front and side. Inspection, a single ulcer of size 1.5 into 1.5 centimeter is seen over the right side of cheek, extends approximately 1 centimeter the outer canthus of right eye, confined to upper part of the face. Circular in shape with raised, beaded and rolled out edges, grayish central scab seen at the irregular margin, no discharge seen and no other similar ulcer seen elsewhere, no obvious swelling seen in the neck. On palpation, no warmth, no tenderness, a single ulcer of size 1.5 cross 1.5 cross 0.2 centimeter is palpated over the right side of the cheek, extends approximately 1 centimeter below the outer canthus of right eye, confined to the upper part of the face, raised, beaded and rolled out edges present, hard and irregular margins with surrounding induration was present, a grayish scab palpable at the floor, base is formed by the facial muscles, no bleeding on touch, not fixed to the bone and underlying muscle. Ulcer is mobile in all directions along with and could be lifted along with the skin. no other swelling palpable in the face or neck. Other examination, CVS is S1, S2 is heard, no murmurs. Respiratory system, normal vesicular blood sounds heard, no added sounds. Her abdomen is soft, non-tender, and no tenderness and no organomegaly. She has no focal neurological deficit and spine cranium are normal. My provision, this is a case of right cheek cutaneous malignancy. Probably this is a carcinoma.
Balapriya, how can you come to a pathological diagnosis of basal cell carcinoma? Why can't it be a malignant nodular ulcerative nodular malignant melanoma? You can't come to a pathological diagnosis.
First of all, it is an elderly female. And it is the location is in the upper part of the face, and the edges of the ulcer is round, rolled out edges with beaded and raised edges, and there is a central scab formation is also seen.
I think basal cell carcinoma is a clinical diagnosis, need not be a pathological diagnosis. Clinically, we can make a diagnosis of basal cell carcinoma.
We can, but it can be a nodular, an ulcerated nodular malignant.
Balapriya,
sir. Yes, sir.
What is the difference between cheek and the face?
This is exactly wonderful. Why do you ask this? A cheek?
You are a postgraduate, you have started yourself with the wrong description. First thing you should realize, what is cheek? Can you tell me? So you get stuck.
Cheek, it's a part of face.
Where is this lesion?
It's very close, it's
very close to the what?
To the outer canthus of the eye, sir.
You only described it very close to the outer canthus, a centimeter below. So first thing you should realize, such small mistake you should not. Okay. Simple thing is. A lesion on the outer aspect of the face. Very simple. Close to the eyebrow, eyelid.
Or a maxillary region.
Oh, whatever. Close to the, sir, the anatomical, anatomical words some examiners do not accept. All right, but safe word, no. Very safe word.
But not cheek.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Did you ask for history of epistaxis or loosening of teeth or dental problem? Did you look into the mouth?
No, sir, I didn't ask for epistaxis for this patient or loosening of teeth.
You must, because it could be involving the maxilla, right? And
okay,
so this is important because we want to know the depth.
In the history, you are asking about arsenic, tar, and radiation. What is the sun exposure?
Yes.
Sir. Sun exposure is more patient who is exposed to ultraviolet radiation, they are more prone for skin cutaneous malignancies.
No, have you explained that? Because you are specifically saying there is no arsenic, no tar, and
yes, she most of farmers and gardeners, they will be exposed to sun. The patient is a housewife by occupation, and there is no much exposure to sun.
Do you think in the South Indian patients, do you think even if you stay inside the house, you think you are not exposed to hot sun? Don't you think so? Do you think they sit in the house? They have to earn their livelihood. They would have been definitely working. Answer this question. What is country man sleep? What is country man sleep? You know or you don't know?
No, I don't know.
You only said just now farmers who are exposed to the sunlight, sun actinic rays falls more on the lower lip compared to the upper lip. So lower lip cancers, it is not basal cells, but these are all exposed areas. As Jailal said, that is what you should try to understand.
Okay,
case has no ulcer, it is only rice. Why not? It is a benign condition.
It was small for 6 years, and recent 6 months it has started to increase in
Do you think that kind of transformation is taking place in basal cell carcinoma?
Yes, sir. In a small nodule, like a recent increase in size and with the irregularity in the margins, it can
turn out to be... If you say size is altered, borders are, margins are altered, you think in the melanoma? In basal cell carcinoma, you are not thinking in terms of border, asymmetry. That thing is not there.
The patient said she developed it for past 6 years, and as there was no pre-existing mole or anything, so I thought.
What is correct to acanthoma?
Are part again.
It is a benign condition for. Basal keratic, seborrheic keratosis.
It will be exactly like this, the cup-like deformity in the center with that, because here you are not having an ulcer, you are having a central scar.
It's a scab formation.
Postgraduate should realize one important thing. As you are examining, you will get ultimately a diagnosis correct. You look back and try to understand the basic behavior of the disease. You are asked discussing basal cell carcinoma and you are telling abdominal distension, jaundice and all that thing. Why did you ask that questions?
Peripheral pulses, all pulses.
Is it malignant melanoma? Yes, very aggressive compared to the basal cell carcinoma, the least aggressive among the cutaneous malignancies. So it's all not required, but rightly put it, local destruction, maxilla, orbital plate here. That is why
it is called rodental.
Okay. Balapriya, a couple of questions. First, that area you hear is called, what is that area called in where this ulcer is, this basal cell carcinoma seed? What is this called? What is this area called?
Tear.
Medial
area. Tear area.
If it is close to the medial,
it is called tear area.
Tear area.
Because it. Now, what is the basic difference between what is a basal cell? What is a basal cell? What is the function of basal cell?
So, it is the innermost layer of the skin, which is having a columnar, single layer of columnar cells. So, and it is having a cytoplasm with filaments.
I'm asking you, what is the function? You're telling me the histopathological.
Keratin.
It produces new cells. Yes. Okay, now what is the basic difference between a squamous cell carcinoma and a basal cell carcinoma? What are the differences?
So the squamous cell carcinoma, it will have clinically it will have inverted margins, sir.
It arises from which layer?
Don't go into the clinical findings. You tell me what is the basic difference between the two.
You said basal cell carcinoma arises from basal cell layer. Then squamous cell carcinoma?
It arises from the epidermis, so squamous cells.
Basal cell is part of epidermis.
Can you tell the 5 layers of the skin, Dr. Balapriya?
Stratum corneum, stratum lucidum, stratum granulosum, and stratum spinosum, and stratum basal.
Very good.
No, okay. Now tell me, what is the difference? If you are supposed to write a short note on differences between squamous cell carcinoma and basal cell carcinoma, what are the 4 or 5? What are the points you're going to put? How does squamous cell carcinoma arise? Have they got pre-malignant conditions? Do they arise from pre-malignant conditions? What about basal cell carcinoma? Does it arise from a pre-malignant condition or not? Basal cell carcinoma?
Squamous cell carcinoma arises from the pre-malignant conditions, sir.
What about basal cell carcinoma?
Basal cell carcinoma, they... don't arise from the pre-malignant condition.
Look, no, Balapriya.
No, you are wrong, Balapriya. Xeroderma pigmentosa, albinism, and Bowen's disease, they are very common for All the three malignant.
Melanoma can also come from that. So everything is common.
Okay. Look, Balapriya, you will be in basal cell carcinoma. You will not be just, because it's a very small chapter, it's a very small entity. You will be asked on melanomas, you'll be asked on squamous cell carcinomas, you'll be asked on basal cell carcinomas, right? So you have to know these three entities when you come to present this case.
Suppose in a young person, multiple basal cell carcinoma, what genetic abnormality you will think? Gorlin syndrome
can be this. It is a multiple basal cell carcinoma with bifid ribs and medulloblastoma can be there.
A lot of things. Medulloblastoma, that is androgenic.
Why didn't you get lymph nodes in this patient? Why don't you get lymph nodes in this patient? You said there are no other swellings.
Basal cell carcinoma, it is a locally invasive tumor, sir, and there will be a desmoplastic reaction following fibrosis of the surrounding tissue, which leads to the obstruction of the lymphatics, sir.
Dr. Balapriya, in duration, you get in basal cell carcinoma more or in squamous cell carcinoma or epithelioma? You understood the question, no? In duration, please tell. In duration
is more squamous cell carcinoma.
Then which condition you get? Which condition you get more desmoplastic reaction, infiltration? Tell me. Is it related to the fibrosis part or is it size of the emboli? One of the explanation given is the basal cell carcinoma, the emboli size is little more, which cannot enter the lymphatics. The reason why it has been mentioned as it doesn't spread by lymphatics, even though it is part of the skin. This is the explanation mentioned. I don't know any other explanation there, please. Sir.
If the lymph node is positive, then it goes very high. It is a very advanced stage. That's like a metastasis, we think.
And by pushing it. It is not known as a rodent ulcer because it buries. It doesn't infiltrate.
Infiltrates.
That is why you don't get this lymphatics and you don't get metastasis through the blood vessels. It just pushes things around. Right? That is why.
If you see that histological pattern, there is a central, you have an oval shape, then the palisading will come. Only the peripheral cells only will divide. That is not, no possibility of spreading from the center. It will not go, the contiguous spread will be there, but lymphatic spread will not be there, as rightly said by sir. One is the size of the emboli is also very high, very okay. Comparatively larger.
What are high risk basal cell carcinomas? What are high risk basal cell carcinomas?
Sir, if the size of the tumor is more than 2 centimeters, and if there is a if it is fixed to the underlying structures and if it is a recurrent ulcer, then it is high risk. And elderly person is having high risk.
Any type, histological type, any particular type of basal cell carcinoma? What is infiltrative type? What is morphia type?
Right.
So if the types is, it's a spreading type, nodular types. And cystic type, it can be pigmented type, and morphia type. Morphia type, it arises from pre-existing nodules, sir. And the geographical fire field type is most, which have the cupping in the center and actively proliferating in the peripheries.
So. Not fire field, it's a field fire. Okay.
Field fire. Yes.
So what is a field fire? What is a field fire? Now let's come. Simple.
It keeps spreading. Peripherally, it is very active. Margins of the tumor is active in the periphery. And central, it is less active. So it forms a scab formation in the center due to dying of cells in the center.
Okay, so for high
type of ulcer, you normally get that field fire appearance ulcer is very common in one type of infection. Lupus vulgaris. Cutaneous tuberculosis, the typical we what we say is the field fire appearance.
So Dr. Balapriya, one other observation you should know. What type of ulcers normally you get scabbing? What is scabbing indicates? You get an ulcer in your skin, it heals with the scab. Scabbing indicates?
It's a long standing.
Scabbing indicates healing.
Healing.
Except basal cell carcinoma is an exceptional malignancy in the sense it is so slow growing, there is a tendency for healing. The reason why they come after 5 years or 6 years like that. See, it doesn't happen like this in a squamous cell carcinoma, melanoma, etc. So that is one observation you should know. That is why it is good prognosis, very slow growing. Okay, right.
It commonly occurs in the epidermal layer. Normally, when the epidermal layer heals by the surrounding skin. So once the disease spreads down, the superficially it can go for a healing. The epithelialization will take place.
In melanoma, it will go down to the dermis.
Okay, now how will you manage this patient? Let's see how you manage it.
Sir?
How will you manage?
Sir, I would like to confirm my diagnosis by doing an Edgewedge biopsy for this patient.
Edgewedge biopsy here.
Do you think you need that?
You need that biopsy or any other biopsy? You will.
The Edgewedge biopsy, because the to find the actively proliferating margin and to differentiate from normal skin tissue and the malignant tissue, sir.
No, you need that is a little more. I mean, increased stress. No, you need to make an incision and take it out.
You said it is free from deeper structures, right?
Yeah.
Clinically.
Yes, sir.
What can you?
Or excision, wide local excision. I can go for a wide local excision, sir, excision biopsy, and then with the adequate with 4 to 5 mm clear margin, and with the flap cover of the underlying defect.
You will be justified in saying either a wedge biopsy or a punch biopsy because one of the differential diagnoses is melanoma, where we need to see the depth of the ulcer. Whenever the penetration, we need to assess. So that is otherwise a shave biopsy or a superficial biopsy is enough to take a diagnosis. Or as you said, it is excisional biopsy. If it is a very small tumor, you can even do the excision. Any other investigation you will do?
Any other news, yeah.
Sir, I would like to do an X-ray of the face and CT of the head region, sir. Since this lesion is not fixed, it is mobile. It means that it is not encroached by any bone or underlying tissue. But if it is fixed, it will be helpful for us to check it from the CT. There is bony erosion or bony involvement is seen or not.
Suppose you take a biopsy and it comes as a melanoma.
If it is a melanoma, I will just first check for whether the depth is negative for. I'll assess the depth of the lesion and thickness of the lesion, sir. Thickness of the lesion. Based on that, I will do excision and I will also work up for lymph node metastasis. For sentinel node metastasis, sentinel node, I will just check for the sentinel node whether it is metastasis or not.
So, what your answer should be, don't say all that I will look for sentinel node and all that thing. So, what is the drainage area of the face here? Which
part? It is to the parotid group of lymph nodes.
So, what you should give an answer, not sentinel node. What you should tell?
Say,
either you straight away ask for an ultrasound of the neck and the face region here, If you are still, you can do a CT scan, no problem. Mention chest X-ray, very important here. The question asked was malignant melanoma. Sentinel node comes later, okay? So first you say evaluate for metastatic workup. That is what you should use the word. After that you discuss further.
So chest X-ray, I will do a chest X-ray and look for any lung metastasis. I will do an ultrasound abdomen to rule out liver metastasis for this patient.
Okay, now you are confirmed it is a basal cell carcinoma. What type you are expecting this? Clinically? The nodular or infiltrative type?
Nodular type, sir.
Okay, which is the commonest type?
Superficial spreading type is more common.
Sir. That is for melanoma, ma, not for basal cell carcinoma. Basal cell carcinoma, nodular is the commonest.
Nodular is common.
So how you are going to manage?
Sir, I will do a wide local excision for this patient, sir. With the since the lesion is close to the eye. I would like to give margin of clearance of 2 mm to 3 mm, sir. Normally, we give 4 to 5 mm margin of clearance, but it is close to eye. I would like to give 2 to 3 mm, sir.
It is not close to eye. It is much away from the eye, at least 2 cm away from the lower margin, lower lid.
Sir, little bit of induration was there on palpation, sir.
Any other conservative method you go, or you straight away go for a surgery? Patient is very cosmic. Though she is 60 years, she may be looking for, I want very cosmetically, I need a good result.
Sir, but it is, when it is close to eye, we will advise the patient to go for surgical options, sir, because we can't give any radiotherapy when it is close to the eye, nose, or critical area of face.
Radiotherapy, the post-operative will be much more worse. First radiation will be much more worse than the surgery. So, for the cosmetic reason, we will not prefer radiotherapy.
Cryotherapy or chemotherapy can do even so.
What is the side effect of cryotherapy? Again, the cosmetically, it will not be a good one. It will produce a halo, white, hypopigmentation. Hi, edema.
For your case, you are telling chemotherapy here for basal cell carcinoma?
No, sir. Wide local excision.
No, she sir? Said cryotherapy. Cryosurgery, she said. What is Mohs surgery?
What probably good is, once you do a local wide excision, you say in the exam, if I am not able to close properly, the best is to take a help of a plastic surgeon, you can straight away tell, for a local rotational flaps. I think that is what is better. From whatever be the, whether she's 60 years or 16 year old, I think we will give respect to the patient. You understand what I'm telling? So, but if the size is less than 2 cm, if you're able to close directly without any much scarring, you can always do. Most of the lesions are very small. Even your case, you have explained that. But what happens is when you give a margin all around, closure becomes difficult. So a slight rotational flap, a Romberg flap or whatever it is, that is usually helps in the rotational flaps, help in the face. It heals very good and give a good results. That is what I think is expected from you.
Yes.
Balapriya, you are telling very close to eye, very close to eye. Let me ask you, if it is on the eyelid, what are the possibilities of malignancies?
What is the most common?
I think you should give the answer, sir, Andar, yes, sir, please. Before Rajiv sir's question is.
Carcinoma, then CBSCS carcinoma. These are all more of a theoretical questions. And third one is squamous cell carcinoma. The differential diagnosis, this is all theoretical, let me tell you, of CBSCS carcinoma is it looks, may mimic like chalazion or inflammatory process like blepharitis. This is all you need to remember, as this is a discussion going on. And you were insisting on eyelid. So these are the things.
Add one trichelemoma. Find
yes.
out.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Last time also in parotid, you see,
carcinoma is most common.
Spreads to parotid. Yes, sir. I remember.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Yes.
Can you describe this ulcer very well, ma? Once again, how did the basal cell carcinoma?
This is an ulcer of size 1.5 into 1.5 centimeter with raised edges and beaded edges and rolled out edges with central scab
raised,
formation.
Beaded, rolled out. All three. Raised, beaded, rolled out. Okay.
The rolled out edges.
Okay.
Rolled out edges with the central scab formation, sir.
Okay, I just ask you one basic.
Why are the edges rolled out? Sir, the proliferating cells falls one above the other in the periphery, sir.
Right, the proliferation is on the inside. It overgrows the outer rope. So that's right.
What is the, what do you remember in the histology of basal cell carcinoma?
So, in histology, there will be a densely packed, darkly stained cells with peripheral palisading appearance, and the stroma will be fibrovascular. Stroma will be fibrovascular types.
Mitosis.
Mitosis will be absent. ATPA will be there. So nuclear cytoplasmic ratio will be increased.
One of the things you should remember, in all other carcinoma, we will say increased mitosis. In the basal cell carcinoma, there will not be mitosis. Normally, we will not see any mitosis. Yes,
Balapriya, tell me one condition mimics histologically as well as behavior-wise a basal cell carcinoma.
Sir.
It is benign actually. Adamantinome. Okay. Adamantinome. Okay, sir.
Balapriya, you asked the difference between the cell of origin is normal cell carcinoma and basal cell carcinoma. So you said basal cell is not the basal. What about normal cell? You didn't finish. I just got back.
Sir.
Normal cell is from?
No.
The whole epithelium of
it is from
next to basal cell.
It is it's the whole epithelium of the here, it's only the basal cell, there's the whole epithelium.
Okay,
commonly from the prickle cell.
Prickle cells, yes.
You were telling about the Mohs surgery. What is that Mohs surgery?
Sir, it's not.
Mohs micrographic surgery. What is that?
Sir, Mohs, it is a surgery done along with histopathologist in theater. It is to, if we are not able to compromise the anatomical surface and we want to, the margin of clearance will be assessed initially by removing the primary tumor. And it is properly marked with the colored tags, and then it is sent for frozen section histopathology. And the clearance margin of clearance will be in, told whether it is positive or negative. And that area we can increase our margin of clearance. Where it is the corresponding tagged area, we will increase the margin of clearance, and again that will be giving the whether it is positive or negative margins.
They all read that very well, sir. Reading part is very good.
What is the full name of the Mohs?
Sir?
What is MOHS stands for?
Microscopic Operative Histographic Surgery.
Are the basal cell carcinoma radiosensitive or not?
It's a radiosensitive tumor, sir. But post-radiotherapy, there are more chances of forming recurrence, and basal squamous type of malignancy can occur, sir.
Highly expensive.
So what is the contraindication of giving the radiotherapy in the basal cell carcinoma?
Sir, when the lesion is very close to the eye, nose or critical area of face, or when it is the underlying fixity to the cartilage or bone, then we do not give radiotherapy, sir. And if it recurs after radiotherapy, we go for surgical excision.
And in this case, if you do a wide excision of 5 millimeter size, how you are going to reconstruct that? What are the various ladders for the reconstruction of this?
Sir, first I will measure the size of the defect, sir. The size of the lesion along with the margin of clearance which I have given.
No, we are talking only this patient. It's a 2 centimeter lesion, so 5 millimeter margin means it will make 3 centimeter defect.
Yes, sir.
So, how you are going to cover that 3 centimeter defect?
Sir, I can. I will go for a rotation flap, or I can. Being it a face, so I will go for a full thickness skin graft from the supraclavicular region, sir.
What are the other places from where you can take the full thickness graft? Apart from the supraclavicular,
sir, the places where we can take it from places where we can do primary closure. That is from the groin, from thigh, from cubital fossa we can take, sir, from the abdomen also, because there are adequate loose tissues.
You are going to construct this flap,
yes, sir.
Full thickness flap on the face.
Full thickness graft. Yes,
graft. I say taking full thickness graft on the face. So you like to take it from where? From the groin?
No, sir. I will match it with the color of
You tell about this case. You don't want saying anything. I can take it from here and here. For this case, where will you take it from? Which is the ideal place to take it from?
For this patient, the supraclavicular region.
Dr. Kanagavali is giving you the hint.
Behind the ears.
Okay, sir. Hidden.
It's closest to your face. You can take it from here and put it here.
Okay, sir.
You take it from closest to around that place.
Okay, so if you have to take the flap, what flaps can you take in this area, Jay? No, you should know a little of the plastic surgery also, Jay.
Very good. You must. Yes.
What flap? The full thickness flap I'll take. Sir.
What are the named flaps, ma? From where?
Full
what
thickness
are
flap.
Flap is always full thickness. Flap is always full thickness.
Full thickness.
What does it contain that makes the difference? Is it just a skin, or it's a fat, or it's a fascia, or the muscle, or the bone?
It contains skin alone. So there are different types of skin flaps, sir. Simple skin flap, composite flap,
I'm not talking about the theory about that. In this patient, if you have to put a flap, what type of the flap that would be called as?
I will put a skin flap.
No, it will be skin flap, no doubt about that. I'll be a rotational flap, or it will be a transposition flap. No?
Okay,
so you can rotate a flap, or you can transposition the flap there. So transposition flap can be taken from the pre-parotid area, which is there in the parotid area. Or you can take the rotational flap, like the nasolabial flap, you can rotate. You can take it from the forehead. The forehead flap you can be taken. It can be taken from the cheek. Okay. Face is very vascular. You know? So you can maintain a ratio about 4:1 here, depending upon the artery which is there. So you can easily rotate a flap in that area. Okay. Well, how does the skin graft? Sorry. Yeah, Dr. Sahib, please.
What is the difference between a rotational flap and a transpositional flap? Now that we're talking about flaps.
So transposition flap, we take it from the adjacent skin and we place it on the defect, sir. Example, a Limburg's flap is a transposition flap, sir.
And then what is the rotational flap? Transposition means you're taking it from one position to another, isn't it? So you've got it the other way. Rotational flaps are here. A Lindbergh flap is a rotational flap. It's not a transpositional, right?
Rotational.
If I take it from here, if I bring it here like that, these are, forehead flap is a transpositional flap based on the, which artery?
Superficial temporal.
Temporal. Okay.
Superficial temporal artery.
So it's based on one artery and you take it down.
So how does it, if you put a skin graft there, how it is going to survive?
Sir.
How first, does a skin graft survive?
First few days, how it survives, then how it survives.
Sir, it takes blood supply from diffusion.
No, blood supply will come later on. What will happen initially? Initial 24 to 48 hours, what does happen? Okay, the fluid which is there, imbibition which is there.
Imbibition and inner.
Yeah, right. And then starts the new vascularization of that. And then there is a maturation of that. So these are the various stages of the skin graft. Now, what are the places where you can use the skin graft and what are the contraindication of putting the skin graft? What are the places where you cannot put the skin graft?
Sir, when there is a underlying bone is exposed, we can't put a skin graft, sir.
Okay, bone and, without the periosteum. That, okay, so bone without the periosteum, tendons without the peritoneum, nerves without the surrounding sheath which is there, or it's on a bone where the some activity is going on a joint which is there or a hollow cavity is there, you cannot put the skin graft there. There you require to have the skin flap in that area there. And what are the indication of putting the full thickness skin graft? If there's a defect of 10 centimeter size is there, can you put a full thickness skin graft?
No, sir. When it is a smaller defect, we can go for full thickness skin.
Yeah, so it's a small defect is there up to about 2.5 to 3 centimeters. You can go for a full thickness skin graft there, okay? But otherwise, if it is a bigger defect is there, then you have to always put a flap there. What is the difference between a flap and a free flap? What is the difference between a flap and a free flap?
Free flap, we remove along with the blood supply. And we do micro.
Sir, I think I will request you to give a short list of the flaps, type of the flaps, and how you nomenclature of the flaps for the benefit of the students. Sir.
I think there are various ways of flaps which are there. So basically, one is there's a flap or it's a free flap. Flap means that it is there from where there is intact blood supply coming from the donor side. While in the case of the free flap, you completely detach the flap from that area and you anastomose it at some other place and you do the vascular anastomosis there. Then the flaps will depend upon that what type of the flap it is, whether it is a random flap is there or it's an axial flap is there. Random flap is where you exactly do not know that what is the supply of that particular flap, but where you know exactly that what is the supply of that particular flap, that is a axial flap. Like if you are doing a rectus abdominis flap, you know it is being supplied to a superior epigastric artery or it is being supplied to an inferior epigastric artery. So the pleural flap which is there, you know it is supplied to the thoracodorsal artery which is there. So depending on if you know that what is the blood supply of that, then that is axial type of the flap. Axial flaps can be, you know, you can have a very long excess of that. So with a very small pedicle which is there, which may be just a 1 centimeter or 2 centimeter flap, which is containing their blood vessel, but it can take a big chunk of the tissue. Then third way is that what type of the flap it is, whether it is just a skin flap which is there, or it is a fasciocutaneous flap, or it is a myocutaneous flap is there, or it is osteomyocutaneous flap is there. So depending upon the requirement of that particular area, like in this particular patient, you will require only the some type of the just the fasciocutaneous flap or along with the small fat which is there, which will be required. So this is the way that you can broadly divide your flaps which are there for the plastic surgery. And you should know a little bit about that, that what are the various ways you can take the flap, what are the various good, like this pectoral flap which is there, this is called the workhorse for the facial surgery which is there. So you can take that particular flap for the reconstruction of the, like if you are doing a patient, the oral cancer is there, you are doing a big defect which is there, do you require just the skin or you do require the mandible also? So you can take the fibula for that, or you can take the clavicle for that, you can take it from the occipital bone. So depending upon that, what is the requirement of that particular area, you will take the flap with that particular tissue there.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. So, Balapriya, would you like to ask any questions to the faculty before closing? You have any doubts?
No, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Abhay, sir, I want your closing comments. Students are expecting your questions. Prakash Jaiswal, I want you to be on the screen because sir was not there, but still pseudosis questions are very popular with Abhay, sir. So, both the students for a few questions.
No, I was not there most of the time. So, as far as your two cases are concerned and the students are concerned, there are two things I want to tell you. The first case possibly was a pseudocyst. Yeah. Now, if you get a case of pseudocyst, there are some things which you got to know. Number one, how do you define pseudocyst? Because definition of pseudocyst has changed over the years. For that, you have to read Atlanta Classification of Acute Pancreatitis, which was described in 2012 and has been modified recently, I think in 2018 or something like that. So you have to read this. Without reading this, you cannot come to an exam, whether it is theory or practical. The second important thing which the examiners are definitely going to ask you is modality of treatment. Because again, the treatment is multimodal. It can be conservative. It can be UHG guided. It can be endoscopic. It can be surgical. Surgical can be again divided into laparoscopic or minimally invasive and invasive, that is open technique. You've got to know what is a step up pattern and step down pattern, etc., etc. So these are the things which you expect. And if you go into discussion of this aspect of pseudocyst of pancreas, let me tell you, surely you are going to just sail through. So somehow or the other reach the treatment aspect of pseudocyst. That's number one. The second thing about ulcer on nodule, I'm not a real expert at it, but anything to do with external aspect of the face, remember you are going to be asked definition of what is epidermis, what is dermis, layers, all these questions are important and they are asked. So prepare well about that. The second thing that you should know is what is where you are going to take biopsy from, what is the edge of the ulcer. The second is how does this spread? Because anything on the face can be a squamous cell, it can be a rodent ulcer, that is basal cell carcinoma, it could be melanoma or any other diagnosis which has been listed. But these are three main diagnoses which are going to be discussed in a short case or a long case and quickly. So histopathological finding, histopathological findings of each one of them are important in discussion. You should know them. The treatment also, just now the treatment went on to details of flaps, etc., etc. To be very frank, if you can reach flaps, it's wonderful. You are going to get good marks. But Balapriya, remember, I was just in the last part of the presentation and discussion of treatment of these things. Do not try and push yourself in because you went horribly wrong. You kept on talking about limber, linger, something like that. And then when you were asked rotational and transpositional, you were exactly wrong. So don't get into things when you do not know the basic foundation of what are the flaps. Much better to say, sir, these are beyond my purview. It is plastic surgery problem. I know that a flap reconstruction has to be done. And I will call a plastic surgeon to reconstruct and get out of the situation because 3 out of 4 examiners will pass you. Yes. Basic principles of flap, which Dr. Khanna said are important. You have to know the basic principles of flaps in general surgery. That can be a short note question for sure. Flaps in general surgery. This can be a short note question in theory examination. you got to be prepared for it. But not really the named flaps, fancy flaps. These are not going to encourage any examiner, but only prompt him or her to ask you further questions, and then you get into a full stop. The last thing that I want to tell you, both of you all, I was not there for the entire presentation, but examiner can make out, especially Balapriya, when you are tentative and when you are sure. Many a times you were tentatively answering the question and waiting for response from the examiner. Examiners have been nice enough to guide you even further because they want to impart knowledge to the other PGs too. So if you are unsure of something, better to say, sir, I'm not very sure, I don't know. Okay, thank you, Kanakle. Thank you. I have to apologize. I was in a meeting because Mumbai is really taken by storm and I'm working in a government hospital. So I was in some meeting after meeting, and monsoons are around the corner. We are, as a general surgery unit or a department, left in a corner of the hospital, and we are dreading any disaster like a building collapse, and we don't know what to do. So that was a meeting that was going on. So I was delayed. I'm extremely sorry for that.
Thank you for joining, thank sir. You, because you. A lot of students were expecting you. Kanna sir and Yandarya sir, for your closing comments, sir.
I think in the Prakhar case, probably there was not much of a differential diagnosis in this patient because the patient had a history of pancreatitis followed by the lump which was there, and the lump was classically in the area where it should be in the pseudopancreatitis. So there was probably not much of the differential diagnosis there, but still the students must know that what is the differential diagnosis in the epigastric and the umbilical. Now regarding the Balapriya case which is there about the, there's no doubt that the first diagnosis she is going to keep a basal cell carcinoma. That's a clinical diagnosis, because clinically we have to differentiate whether it is a benign tumor or it's a malignant tumor. And in the malignant tumor category, the usually on the face which is there will come as a basal cell carcinoma or a squamous cell carcinoma and sometimes a melanoma. Now this was a black pigmented tumor which was there, and that is why you have to keep a possibility of that this patient might be having a. And then the blackish, you know, you can have the squamous cell carcinoma also, the which may have the blackish pigmentation, and the basal cell carcinoma. All the three can have the blackish pigmentation. And then the benign tumors also should be kept, like the keratoacanthoma, which is there, and the benign adnexal tumor, which are there, like the trichoelomoma may be there, or the seringoma may be there, or the adenomas may be there. All these are the benign tumors which are there from the skin should be kept in also mind, though they are not usually forming a differential diagnosis. The differential diagnosis probably in this patient is only between the basal cell carcinoma and probably for a melanoma. But I think the basal cell carcinoma is the right diagnosis, a single diagnosis in this patient. And the treatment for that, because until unless it is a invading tumor, then it's a difficult treatment. If it is invading, the maxilla is there, invading the bone which is there. But otherwise, a straightforward treatment for the basal cell carcinoma, probably you will not require a biopsy because you are going to go for a wide excision in this patient with a 5 mm margin, keeping it as a diagnosis of basal cell carcinoma. Probably the histopathology preoperative may not be required in this patient. But if you are thinking in terms of melanoma, then definitely you should have to have the biopsy to decide that what will be the margin of excision in this patient. And the usually on the face when it's there, you will require some type of the rotational flap which is there for the reconstruction, because it's on the face, though it is an elderly lady, but still you will definitely require to maintain the cosmesis of the face. So that will be the ideal treatment for this patient, the wide excision of the 5 mm margin with a flap repair. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Andarya,
but,
sir.
But both the students did very well. I think Prakhar did very well. Yeah, Prakhar did very well. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Congratulations to both the students. I think today was a different day. First case, pseudocyst being, the more emphasis is to be given on history, examination, then investigation and management. This usually comes in mostly long case as well as sometimes short case. The Balapriya's case was more of clinical inspection, palpation, and then more of pathology. So every PG student must read. I think my advice is to keep a pathology book of Robbins and further surgical pathology along with preparations of such cases. That will be absolutely helpful. many cases are helpful by reading the pathophysiology. That will give you how to correlate symptomatology and then the management. And in case of melanoma, more is histopathology and the other behaviors, which is important. So today was a complete case of how to assess clinical history, examination, pathology. But for each and every case, you must know basic pathology as well as histology of the malignancies. That will be very helpful. And as far as planning of management of any disease is concerned, you can, if you have time, go through medicine's book of Harrison, which in nutshells give you how to manage, not what to do, what is the process, but what is the plan of management. These two books to me are mandatory for you. And the discussion of flaps, everybody should know basics, as Khanna sir and Rajiv Sahai sir said, Dalvi sir also emphasized on that. What are the different basic flaps? You may be asked in CA breast, you are many a times asked DIEP flap. That is very helpful nowadays and being done for simple mastectomy, total simple mastectomy with sentinel node biopsy. So I think today was a good selection of cases as far as history, clinical examination, management, histopathology is concerned. But each and every case requires all this aspect. This is what you have to keep in mind. Congratulations to both the students and well done.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Vivek, sir, your word, sir.
Yeah, this first case presentation, he has to say that a positive history should be elaborated. He said about the fever 5 days, that's all. What type of fever? Why is the fever asking? Any positive history should be elaborated. Another thing, after that general examination, vitals should not be told that initially. After final only, you have to say another thing, that is a local examination, very, very important for long case. He is saying about systemic examination, then last only is saying about the local examination. So local, during presentation, you should follow the procedures. Don't confuse that last side and front like that. This is the presentation, very, very important, because short time, you should not do any mistakes in the presentation. That's what first case. Other things you are doing well. The second case is she should do lot of basic knowledge. See the difference between that is squamous cell carcinoma, basal carcinoma. These things should know very well. Otherwise, both of them nicely presented. Even though she's second HPG is doing well. That's all. Thank you.
Jailal, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Both the students have done well, but especially for the second candidate, you need to concentrate more on cutaneous malignancy, the etiology, all the factors, how it is going on, each how it differs, the layers, and from where it starts. What are the pre-malignant conditions? What are the, how the pathology is there? And a little more thorough understanding has to be there. And classification and what type. And the third is a histology. As rightly said by Andheriya sir, this, histology is very, very particular and you must be very cautiously look into that. That is a really little help you in a lot of way in answering your question. If you are confident in that, in many questions, you will be able to answer. Because though it's a basal cell carcinoma, it's a small topic. But what you had to read along with the basal cell carcinoma, melanoma, and squamous cell carcinoma, you had to study. And recent advances, some of the, suppose the surgeon has come in with the recent advances with the micrographic surgeries and photodynamic therapy and other therapies. And they may be also asking that question. See, most of the surgeons, we straight away say it's a surgical. But if the examiner has an exposure to that surgery, which is the dermatologist also now started doing a lot of things. So that also